this is Katina, and today we are going to talk about bass clarinet technique. So if you have any questions, please post them in the comments. I am going to start off today, though, talking particularly about articulations. So last week we talked about embouchure, and today we're going to talk about articulations. They are different on the bass than they are on the B-flat, if you're used to playing B-flat. So for me personally, when I'm playing B-flat, I have my very strong embouchure, and the tonguing feels very pointed, very close to the tip of the reed. But when I'm playing bass, it feels wider, and I'm using more of my tongue on the reed. So what I thought I would do today is an experiment to see exactly what part of the tongue I'm using and where I'm hitting the reed. So I'm going to use these are my food grade markers, and I'm going to draw a couple of lines. So I'm going to stay with blue and green because red looks like blood and you can't see yellow, and black is just kind of poopish. All right, anyway, so we've got blue and green. So what I'm gonna do is mark the reed where people say we're supposed to be tonguing on the reed. And I'm gonna see if that's where I'm hitting the reed with my tongue. So usually when we're talking about articulations on the B flat, it's way up here at the tip of the reed. For me, I'm gonna go a little bit lower on bass and see if this is the part of the reed that I'm tonguing. So let's give that a try. I'm gonna put this cap back on here, otherwise I won't, and then I will lose it. All right, so. I'll just do that much for now. So if I'm looking over at my reed, I was much closer to the top up here, and so you can see that little bleeding of the ink towards that, and that's normal anyway. So I'm using more of the middle of my tongue than I thought. So to me, it feels like I'm using the tip of my tongue right there, but the blue line is telling me a little bit differently. So it's a little bit further back than I thought, but I'm absolutely hitting that, that part of my reed much closer than I thought too. So now I'm going to try putting a little bit of my tongue. Oh my God, it tastes horrible. I'm going to see where I'm tonguing the reed. Yeah, green was probably not the best choice. Let's try red, because it's blending in with the blue. Oh God, horrible. Yeah, I can't even really see it on here, but to me, it's much closer to the tip of that reed than I thought. So one of the reasons why we're doing this is so that you're not anchor tonguing. That's that big one that we talk about a lot with clarinet, especially B-flat, that people will jam their tip of their tongue behind their top teeth or their bottom teeth and tongue that way. And I can't even demonstrate it on the bass. I can demonstrate it on the B flat. So watch out for that. You don't want to be anchor tonguing. And the big one, the saddest one that I see, is this glottal stop that people do. So instead of tonguing with their tongue, they actually close off their throat and stop the air. So it's like look, like that. And that one you definitely don't want to be doing. It'll just start hurting your throat. It causes all this muscle tension and you can't tongue very quickly at all. So we're back to the tip of the tongue, close to that tip of the reed there, just like the B flat. And it just feels a little different than B flat just because it's wider. Now, for me, I also have to experiment with where to tongue on the reed in the different ranges of the bass clarinet. So when I'm tonguing lower, I'm not quite going lower on the reed to tongue, but it feels like that I am. Obviously, I'm using a lot of air, blowing way down into the instrument, way down into the floor. When I go over the break, I have to control my air. We're always controlling our air, but I feel like I have to control it in more of this pinpointed way, and I'm really supporting with my abs, but I'm not putting the power into it that I put in that lower range. That is definitely our classic bass clarinet squeak zone right there. I'm sure my husband heard that. He plays the trumpet, and he's going to be like, see? And he's going to come in and make fun of me. So with the going over the break, I have to do much more control with the air, and I can't really force it. You have to be very delicate. And you get used to it, but you have to experiment with where you're going to tongue on that reed where it works for you. All right, I see a question. Dedication is coloring your tongue to show students where to tongue on the bass clarinet. Oh, it's true. It's really fun to have people do that in lessons too. Now I've contaminated all my markers because I put them on my tongue and my reed, so now I have to sterilize them all, and then the ink gets all messed up going to the tip of the marker. So, but yeah, usually I just do a fresh reed and I tongue the fresh reed, and nobody has any germ exchange. Especially now, nobody wants any germ exchange. So, but that's definitely one of our big things that we talk a lot with bass, is getting those good articulations in there. And another one, and this is just something I noticed from doing a lot of clarinet choir, the bass clarinet gets this low part all the time in clarinet choir. And if you're doing any kind of pop covers without a drum set, you need the basses to really articulate clearly and strongly, very defined. I was gonna say defiantly, but that'll work too. Because they're your percussion section, actually, in your piece. They're really driving that beat and keeping that percussive quality to the music. So I've done a clarinet camp for a couple years at Mason, and we always do a cover. And I think last year we did Don't Stop Believing, and the year before that we did Bohemian Rhapsody. And we really needed those basses to have very strong, crisp, clean, clear articulation so that you can have that percussive bass line going in there. Think about a bass guitar when you're able to really pluck those strings. I said pluck, but you know what I mean. That was very classical musician-y of me. Hey, Outfall Gamer, and hi, Eric. So thank you guys for coming. And if you have questions, once again, post them in there. We're talking about articulations, but I'm gonna move on to, move on to other bass clarinet techniques that I see a lot with people. Last week we talked about embouchure. So as a brief reminder, our embouchures are different than when we do B-flat clarinet. They're not quite as forced and firm. So you can have a little bit of more leeway. But yeah, my chin isn't as pointy as when I do the bass. You can see I was just sort of feeling it there to see. So it's a little bit more like that strawberry chin that we try and tell you to avoid when you're playing B-flat clarinet. But you want to have control here in the corners. And that's one of the ways I'll check, is I'll tap that clarinet. And even the tiniest little tap, sometimes it'll fly out of people's mouths if they're not firm enough in here. So you do want that strength and control in there too. Hey, Cat Lover 101. That's a great name. Hopefully my kittens will come by and say hello while we're doing the live stream. So that's embouchure. We talked a little bit about articulation. Always we want to have support, good support. And I know that there are band directors and music teachers out there that say support with your diaphragm. That was something that was said when I was a student. And come to find out, the diaphragm is involuntary muscle, so we can't control what it does. What really people are talking about is supporting with your abdominal muscles right there. So that's your six pack that you're going to work on as a bass clarinetist. Really firm up right there to get that big, strong air out. Blowing way down into that instrument to get that nice, big, full bass clarinet sound. So air, just keep pushing with your abdominal muscles and supporting right in there. Another way that works is just sort of pushing down into your sit bones that I've heard. That'll also work too. But it's hard to talk about support because everybody's body is different. And you can't just be sticking your hand on people's bellies, because that's yucky and awkward. So one of the things that I'll do is get one of those belts that you have for Taekwondo, and you can put it around your waist, and then I have students push out against it while I pull back, and that's a good way to get that feeling of what support is like. Another one that I hear all the time, and I don't know if you guys have this problem with bass clarinet too, is playing up over the break. So people can get over the break, right? You're playing, you know, the A flat A, B flat B natural. Right there, all the way up to that F sharp, works nicely for people on bass. It's getting to that G. So for some reason, going from this part of the clarinet over the break into the G can be challenging. So once and I'm going to assume that all your clarinets are in working condition. That's the first thing you want to check, because this area can leak really easily, especially up in here, and that'll impact this spot. So one of the ways I suggest getting to that G is starting on the F sharp, and you might as well practice the chromatic fingering for the F sharp. So you have F right here, you have your thumb down here, register key, 1, 2, 3, and then this index finger for F, and then your little sliver key here for the F sharp. So start there on the F sharp chromatic fingering, and just slur up to the G. Now go to the F natural, then do the sliver key F sharp, and then the G. Once you can get that to work for you, and once again, it's all this feeling in here in the voicing, tongue position plays a big part of it. Yeah, so I'm opening up my mouth. I'm sort of lifting up the back of my mouth a little bit, so it's more of like a ooh feeling. And then as I move into that G, I just push the back of my tongue up a little bit. Like I'm saying ooh, like that. And then I'm doing that support in there. And then just add chromatically as you go. And you're hearing some clicking in my clarinet, and that's because when I put it together, I didn't line up my bridge key right, and that G sharp key is bumping against my little side C F key. And that's something to watch out for too. So if you're having trouble getting into this higher register of the LT, or the upper register of the clarinet, double check that this isn't bumping into here too. That'll do it. All right, let me see some of the questions that we have. What is your bass clarinet setup? I've never played a good bass. My school has an old wooden LeBlanc that goes to low D. It looks like a dog chewed up the lower joint. Oh gosh, Eric, that's awful. And then you said, I plead for them to keep it inside, but they take it outside. No, and march with it. So it's leaky and horrible. And the floor peg slips too. It was a good horn at some point. Yeah, LeBlancs are good instruments. And I'm just trying to see, yeah, you said it was wooden. The wooden ones need to stay inside, and that's a real shame. If you're taking a wooden one outside, it'll destroy it. And you really can't fix it after a certain point. That'll get cracks, too many cracks to fix. So, yeah, that makes me sad. And it also makes me sad that you said it looks like a dog chewed it up. One of the things, I'm going to see if I can lift up my clarinet enough to show you with the peg. It should have a screw. All of them have a screw. You want to loosen that screw to adjust the peg. And I've seen so many times where I'll come in and do a clinic or a sectional, and people just sort of slam their bass on the ground to move the peg. And that, it obviously is going to break it. But what it does is it strips this mechanism in here. Sometimes it'll break this part straight off. But when that strips, that's why the peg slips. So the next person that uses that bass has to deal with that peg slipping. And it's really annoying. And they're very hard to fix once they get, you know, destroyed like that. You have to actually take it to a repair person and solder a new peg joint on there, which is a real pain. I've actually had people jam pieces of paper up in there, and that kind of helps too, but it's just a temporary fix. Yeah, the wooden ones, they stay inside when I'm working with students and they're ready to move on to a wooden clarinet and they've had the conversation about it with their families. I always say it's like having a really fine piece of furniture. These clarinets, if you take good care of them, they're kind of like heirlooms. You can pass them down to the next generation. I buy a lot of instruments off of Craigslist, or at least I used to, if they were good, to sell to my students and pass along that way. And I met this one woman once, and she was selling it because a B-flat clarinet, because she didn't have enough room in her house anymore. But her dream was that she could give it to her granddaughter, who was just starting in fourth grade, to play the clarinet. And I was like, you know what, don't sell it. Just keep it. It's not a big case. Stick it under your bed. Even a bass clarinet, just stick it in a closet somewhere. And so I wouldn't buy it. And she was like, wait, you're not going to buy it? And I was like, no, you can keep it for your granddaughter. So yeah, you don't want to take them outside. It's interesting that it just goes to low D. Usually they go to E flat. So this is E flat right here. And then in my case, the low D is, let me see, this one here. Nope, that's the E flat. It's right there. It's the one on the end. I'm too high. So there's my D. And then behind here, this is my C sharp and this is my C. So I have them behind my thumb rest, which is really fun to have keys there Because really, what is our thumb doing anyway? So it gives it something else to do. But my D key, that's broken and I need to get that fixed. It's been one of these ones that technicians have not been able to fix for me in a way that I'm happy with. So that's kind of a bummer. You have to take good care of these bad boys. Look at all the mechanism we're dealing with. You see these long rods right here? That's why these cases that they have them in schools are so tragic, because they're just really junky. And so they get all out of alignment really easily. And these bend, you have to really take very good care of a base. So when you're using them in school, hopefully the person that used it before you took really good care of it. That's kind of what we're stuck with. Also, please, 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 please get your own mouthpiece. Don't use those gross mouthpieces that the band room has. And if you have to, please disinfect the hell out of that thing, because those are super gross. It's an LL Series LeBlanc bass. You call it Satan's horn. It's such a shame, because it's really an important part of the band program. And every now and then, you know, the alto clarinet comes up and I have an alto and I really like playing my alto, but you've got to have a good one. And mine's okay. It's a good one, but it's not one of the great, great ones. And it's a plastic one, so I use it occasionally. But you got to have good basses in your band program. So, maybe you guys can have a bake sale when we're all said and done, when we're all back in our band programs. So my bass setup here that I have, this is a Selmer. It's, I don't know what they call them now. There was not a name when I got it. It was just a Selmer with a low C extension. I think it's the Privilege now, but it didn't have a name back then when I bought it in 2002. So it's coming up in 20 years. The neck is the neck that came with it. I know some people will swap out a different neck. They'll get that one with more of that scoop in there, like the buffet necks. My mouthpiece is a Matheson facing. So it's a Selmer C-Star mouthpiece. So I bought the mouthpiece separately than the clarinet. And then I sent it to get a facing done on it by this guy in Chicago, Matheson. And I really like it. I've been very happy with it for a long time. I kind of wanted to try some bass mouthpieces, but then I look at the price tag and I'm like, you know what? My bass clarinet does not get me enough gigs to pay for the new mouthpiece, and that's kind of how I look at it. And my ligature is a Benaud ligature, but I'm going to try some of the new Rovner ligatures that I really like for bass, and just try some different ligatures out. I would like to darken up my sound a little bit. My sound is a little bright for me. Whoops. So to me, there's a little bit too much brightness in it. So I'd like maybe a little bit darker, but I also like the ease that I am able to play with that mouthpiece. So I'm able to get a really big sound out, which I do like. I play a lot of pops. So when I play pops concerts, this is great because I have a saxophone section with me too. Reeds, I use D'Addario reserve reeds, and that's a 3. And so with my quest to maybe darken up my sound a little bit, I'm going to try a little bit harder of a reed. For me, when I try a harder reed though on bass, I don't like sacrificing that big sound. Sometimes it comes with too much stuffiness, and then, you know, then I don't like that. I also don't like working too hard. I'm very lazy. So if I have a reed that I have to play a lot of air for to get a sound out that I want, and it gives me a headache, I'm going to bail on that reed super fast. And that's why I'm still on 3s. I'm very happy with the 3s. So that's my setup there. But it's worked for me for a nice long time. I love this clarinet. It's a good one. And I like the buffet clarinet, but for me, that was a bigger, more open sound. So that was not what I was looking for. So I liked the Selmer because it had more of this condensed feel to it, which I really liked. We have more broken instruments than working. That is really a bummer. You want me to play Careless Whisper on the bass? I'd have to practice that on the bass to get those glissandos in there sounding nice. With band programs that have more broken instruments than working instruments, it's all about the money. And that's what's really hard. And if you're in an area that doesn't have a lot of money, or if you're in an area that doesn't honor the music program and put music in that direction, that makes it challenging. I've worked at schools that are able to put together some good fundraisers so that they can get either instruments fixed or replaced. And what helps with that is not the band director so much. It's more about the students themselves or the parents. So you have to kind of go outside of the actual music department. And I mean, I'm not telling you to go behind your band director's back, but it's to have somebody proactive come in and say, hey, listen, we have a broken bass clarinet. And can we talk to the band parents organization about selling Rice Krispie treats? You know, what can we do to make this work? I've seen good results from that. And good results from parents that are really into the band program really helps too. Because I know you guys are busy. It's like you guys have school and everything also. So it's very hard to run a fundraiser when you're studying for your AP exams. So usually parents are able to help with that. I wish we lived in a world where school districts allocated the money to the band programs that they need. It is a bummer for me to see the sports programs get all that money. It kind of sucks. I have actually worked at schools that have been able to angle it really well with marching band. So they get most of their money from the marching band portion of their funding for schools because the football team is such a big deal. And then if the football team is a big deal, then the marching band is a big deal and they're able to get money in there that way. But I wish I could help you. There is another program called Instruments in the Attic. And if you Google that, maybe there's a chapter nearby where it's basically outreach to people that have instruments. Like I was saying with that lady who had that clarinet under her bed, reaching out to people like that saying, hey, do you have an instrument in your attic that you're not playing? Would you consider donating it to the school program so people actually play it and, you know, get joy out of it instead of it sitting under your bed? But yeah, that's, I see it all the time. And I sadly, now live in a very privileged area, where people have, oh, please don't smack me, Eric, but they have two bass clarinets. They have one bass clarinet for school and one bass clarinet for home to practice on. And then I think about other places where they don't have any at all. So I wish there was a way we could spread that out more. Okay, more questions. I am really bored the past 2 weeks because I want to start playing by ears. If you can help me, that would be great. Okay, you would be thankful. Okay. I'm going to get back to your governor's school thing in a second. Eric, let me talk to Yosef. You're the I'm really bored for the past 2 weeks, I feel like, is just represented like the entire world right now. So playing by ear, that's a great one. I should actually do a video on that. If you haven't been to Ear Spasm yet, that's Michael Lowenstern's channel. He's amazing. He's a fantastic player. He has a section, it's kind of like playing by ear, but he talks about how he does his arrangements for his videos. And when I do covers, I actually, I buy them from people that already did it just because I have a day job and I'm a mom and I do all this stuff. So I don't have the time to put into how he does it, but he puts his videos together by ear. So he does a video on playing by ear like that. But since we're here and we're talking now, one of the things I would do is start small. So start with, if you stick with my channel, you can do it that way, but you can just do it by listening to it. So, and start with one that in your culture is a song that everybody knows. So I start my students with Hot Cross Buns, right? And I'm like, all right, we're gonna start on an E, which is right here. And then I'm gonna have you figure it out, right? So we're starting on E. And then the next note is up or down, right? So hot cross buns, ding dun dun. So we're going down. So for us, that means our fingers go down. I'm gonna sit back a little bit so you can see my fingers, right? And so then I've got that much of it, and then I know it goes da 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 dun dun dun, right? So start like you're learning a new language, right? Like you're a baby and you're just learning how to speak whatever the language is that you learn how to speak. And then start from there. Another one that I recommend looking up is the Suzuki method. This is a big part of the Suzuki method, the playing by ear part. And what they do is they start with Twinkle Twinkle Little Star and you listen to it 30 times a day. 30 times a day. So my daughter, who is doing Suzuki violin, listening to Twinkle Twinkle Little Song 30 times a day, everybody in the family could play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star on the violin by the end because we just listen to it so much. So the big thing is listening to it and obviously having some kind of knowledge of how your instrument works. So if you're doing Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, So it's just listening to it a lot and then picking out the notes, and it's a lot of trial and error. And the big one for us, though, because it's fun to do songs that aren't, you know, 1,000 years old, like Twinkle Twinkle Little Star or Hot Cross Buns. I'm exaggerating. They're like 300 years old. But to do a song that we know, that's going to be just focus on that melody and just work on playing that melody. I don't do this for clarinet, but I have done it for guitar because I'm trying to learn guitar. And there's this app called the Amazing Slow Downer app. So you can do a snippet of the solo that you want to learn, and you can slow it down, and it doesn't change the pitch when it slows down. And then you can try and pick out those notes in there and work your way through that. But it is definitely a lot of trial and error, but the more you do it, the better you get at it. Absolutely. And for me, when I took jazz improv when I was in graduate school, and I was a classical music major, so jazz improv was terrifying for me, my jazz teacher suggested that since I'm comfortable with written music, that find a solo that I like and write it down first and then play it on the clarinet. And that's actually how I learned jazz solos. I would listen to them, write them down, and then learn them on the clarinet. So you've got time. We all have time. Well, except for me. I feel like I'm doing a million things. But yeah, so for playing by ear, those are some of my tips for that. Okay, let me see. Oh, Eric, you're good at writing. Okay, so Governor's School this year, we had a guy play a buffet bass. MTSU. What is that? Which university? That's a university, right? And when he went to, he left the bass on the cold ground and it cracked. That's really bad. Those are very expensive cracks. A bass, that's my worst fear, is a bass crack, because they're so big. And I would just feel sad anyway. He tried to blame it on another student, of course. And one of your friends, I know Kristen Sheridan. And I was supposed to meet her at Allstate Band, but it was canceled here in Tennessee. Kristen Sheridan's amazing. She's a great teacher. So I guess you know her from Swanee Music Festival, maybe, unless you're around here in Virginia and you know her from here. But so Allstate Bands were all canceled. So this whole thing with the coronavirus, besides it's scary because we don't want to get sick, it's scary because we don't want our loved ones getting sick, it's scary because we don't want our loved ones losing their jobs or our parents losing their jobs and things like that. And it's scary because we don't know when it's going to end and we don't know who gets it and why and, you know, all this stuff, right? So all that, put that away for 1 second, because that's all there and that's all real. How many of you lost graduation? How many of you lost prom? How many of you lost things, even like fifth graders going into sixth grade? There's kind of a ceremony feel to that. And I don't work in traditional education anymore. Now I work in alternative education, and a lot of the students that I work with left school because it wasn't working for them, right? So they left and they had put all those things, they had worked it out that they were missing regular graduation and regular proms and stuff like that, right? And now it's all gone. So all those things got canceled. But for me, having students that worked for years, 4, 5, 6 years to get to Allstate Band and have Allstate Band canceled, and that's it, you're a senior, that is just the saddest. I feel so sad for everybody. I think about you guys all the time. And then, of course, we have all the public schools saying, but you need to keep up with all your academics. We don't want you falling behind. And I'm like, really? There's so many other things going on right now. I feel like it's a great opportunity to just find things that you love and that you're really passionate about and want to learn about. So, Yosef, when you were talking about playing by ear, yes, do it. Play by ear. That counts. You're learning something, right? So, anyway, I just want, you know, anybody in here that's under the age of 18, I'm feeling for you guys because of all this. And teachers, so many teachers that are, especially I feel like in music programs, because so much of our work is ensemble and it's very, very personal, and you can't do an ensemble this way. I mean, I have to keep looking over here to see what you're saying in the chat, if we were all in a clinic together, if we were in a rehearsal together, we would be able to have this time to talk to each other. So that's another great loss of this pandemic, is that connection that we have. But a great gift of the pandemic is this connection that we have with people all over the world with live streaming and Zooming and Google Hangouts and things like that. So that, you know, we weren't taking advantage of that as much. I wasn't. So that is a good thing about it. Your friend used to take lessons. Middle Tennessee State University. Okay. Oh, thanks, Yosef. I got dressed today. we all know what I mean. How many people are still in their pajamas? The governor's school professor is Dr. Todd Waldecker. I don't know if I know Todd Waldecker, but yeah, all my stuff is canceled. My recital. Oh, you lost your recital, and I'm really sorry about that. Yes. That's another one. Yeah, concerts and recitals. I didn't even think about all the ends of years recitals that are being canceled for people too. I hope that you guys are able to take care of yourselves. I talked about this in one of my other live streams, and I was recently interviewed, so if I'm repeating myself, please forgive me, those of you who have heard me say this before. So Mason, Georgetown Community Arts Academy interviewed me for just a blog post about what people can do now. And in the questions they sent me, one of them was, how do you tell students to be more productive? Like, what's your advice for people to stay productive during this time? And if there's any indication of how I feel about that based on what I said earlier, it's don't stay productive. Stay happy and stay healthy and care for yourself. I personally read the news too much, and I have to put away my sadness and my fears and my anxiety in a box. It's like I put it in a little box and I put it away. And then we are musicians, so we get to play music for ourselves. We can play for other people too, but a big part of the reason I went into music is because I loved it for me. And it's okay to say that. It's okay to play music for yourself. So I said in this article, I'm like, you know, just play pieces that you love. Yosef, when you were talking about how do you play by ear, play it, just do it because you love it, right? And it will be frustrating when you can't get it. Sometimes I'll Google it if I'm trying to play something by ear. I'll be like, okay, what are the damn notes for this thing, because I can't figure this one out yet. But I've been going back to all the Rose Etudes because I love them. They're beautiful. I have them on my stand right now. I opened the live stream with one of them. They're very beautifully written. If I have some time, I'll get to some Bach Etudes, or Bach cello suites, excuse me, play some Bach. But there's a Coursera course on how to do jazz improv, which I'm thinking about taking because I would like to know more about that. So really, it's just, you know, self-care right now, taking care of ourselves. And if you have academics you have to keep up with, you know, do your best with all that. But really, we can do this. We all can do this. And we can do it together. And we all are caring for each other and taking care of each other. Anybody that's doing self-isolation, you're doing it not just for you, but you're doing it for all the other people that have that are compromised in their immune systems, or that are all elderly. And now it seems like, you know, people, we don't even know why they got it. So I think being able to watch this historic event happening, that's what I'll take away, is how we all made these giant sacrifices. But at least if you have your clarinet at home, you can play some music. Get that acapella app if you have a smartphone or an iPhone. It's fun to play, you know, play some duets with yourself and quartets with yourself. And there's some great arrangements out there, and just play along. So I'm reading yours, Eric. Karma, the guys R13 cracked too. Ooh, that's awful. Yeah, any cracking instruments make me sad. But his parents bought him a new R13, Prestige B-flat and R13A. I'm picking up clarinet during these times. Yeah, me too. And my guitar is in the other room, because if I leave it in here and I record stuff, you can hear it in the guitar. But I'm going to pull my guitar out and just because guitar is really, really hard for me. It's a real challenge. So maybe I'll spend some time really working some stuff by ear on guitar. And I do play three other instruments. Oh, yeah, write them down. And I'll leave you guys with this one horrible story. I had a student years ago that got really mad practicing, because that's never happened to any of us. We've never gotten mad practicing. And so she took her B-flat clarinet like a baseball bat, and she swung it as hard as she could on her dresser, and she broke it in half, right below the middle joint. And her dad sent me an email for a repair person. And I asked what the repair was, and he said the clarinet broke in half. And when I saw that thing, I was like, how did you do this? And she told me what she did, and they couldn't repair it. So her parents brought her a brand new R13. I remember thinking my parents would never have bought me a brand new R13. I would have never had another clarinet again, and I never had another clarinet lesson. But I guess, you know, everybody does it differently. You don't know, you know me. I don't know if I can say my name. Oh, I know you. You don't have to say your name. But that's okay. But that's, now it's a big mystery for me that I know you. Cat lover 101, which is hilarious. Yeah, and that's the other thing for me. This has been a learning curve for me, because sometimes I'll go in public and people will be like, oh my God, it's Katina. Hey, and I don't know who you are. Or then people know me from different events I do, and then I can't remember your name when I see you, and then I feel really bad about that. So that's been one of my things I need to work on. All right, guitar, piano, and main instrument violin. But you're here on the clarinet channel, and you know me. Oh, hey! Oh, yes, I know your name, but I'm not gonna say it either. So hi, tell your family I say hi. All right, I'm gonna sign off. Take care of yourselves. Wash your hands. Don't touch your face. Just play music because it's beautiful and we love it. And sing and listen to lots of music that makes you happy. And I will see you next Monday if you're bass clarinet. And if you're B-flat, that's Friday. Or if you don't care what instrument it is, I'll see you on Friday and Monday. All right. Take care, everybody. Bye.